Angelo Polo in quello che mi chiede sopra la mia. E questa pari completa si viene a mettere a fare.
Thank you. To hear you, be careful. I'll turn them off. Okay.
Is there any
We'll ask the congregation to please stand where able. I am the resurrection and life, says the Lord. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die.
The hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live.
We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we shall carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
If we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living.
Our Savior Christ, he doth abolish death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel.
I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. And I have the keys of death and of hell.
Because I live, you will live also.
And death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain. For the first things are passed away.
We sing the honor and the glory of God. The hymn, "To God be the glory, great things he hath done." Be seated. Let us go to God in prayer. Most gracious God, We turn to you now in the sorrow and grief of our bereavement, praying that we may find the strength we need in your sustaining grace, so that even as we mourn the death of one whom we knew and loved, we may not be overcome by this trial, but we may hold fast, trusting in your goodness and mercy. Assure us, O Lord our God, that death is not the end of those who trust in you, and may our hearts be so composed in the Holy Spirit that all fear and bitterness may be swallowed up in the light and peace you give to your troubled children, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and eternal God, who by the Holy Spirit minister to us in our weakness, and by the victory of your Son, Jesus Christ, have given us the pledge of eternal life, lift us, we pray, above our present distress and sorrow, and shed the light of your grace and glory upon us, the same Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Brothers, sisters, family, present and viewing, allow me to acknowledge amongst those who are with us mourning the Honourable Lindsay Grant, Member of Parliament for Constituency 4, from which our dear deceased sister hailed, the Governor of the Central Bank, almost said Honourable, but Timothy N.J. Antoine. We acknowledge, let me acknowledge Sister Wendy as well, Grant, Dame Constance Mitchum, acknowledge you, our groups, organizations, and permanent secretaries that may be present. We acknowledge your presence, and we pray that your support here would mean much to the family. We invite the following tributes from Gertrude Hobson, sister, that will be followed by Mavis Huggins and Merslin Dolly Gums Hughes, family friends, the nursing fraternity of St. Kitts and Nevis, and then the grandchildren Andrew, Aaron, Owensi, Owen, Saleh, and Renee, in that order. Okay, well, bringing that up, we'll go to Mavis Huggins and Merslin Hughes, Gums Hughes.
Good afternoon, Church. I have heard of a land
on a far away strand, 'tis a beautiful home of the soul, built by Jesus on high, where we never shall die. 'Tis a land where we'll never grow old, never grow old, never grow old. 'Tis a land where we'll never grow old, never grow old, never grow old, in a land where we'll never grow old, in the beautiful home where we'll never more roam. We shall sing in the sweet by and by. Happy praise to the King, through eternity sing. 'Tis a land where we'll never grow.
Mercies are of an unique kind. We have this insatiable need to care for others, which is both our greatest strength and often our heaviest burden. A nurse is one who opens the eyes of a newborn and gently closes the eyes of a dying man or woman. It is indeed a wonderful blessing to be the first to witness the beginning of life and the last to see the end of life. Miss Margery Helen Welsh considered it an honor to serve as a nurse for over 40 years of her life. Mrs. Welsh commenced her nursing career at the age of 20 in 1956 and successfully engaged in the 3-year general nursing program. In 1960-61, she trained as a midwife at the then Cunningham Hospital and was appointed a staff nurse in 1962. Thereafter, working for many years, she was then transferred to community nursing, where after several years of working, she traveled to Jamaica to further her studies and obtain a certificate in public health nursing. Upon returning home, she was appointed as a public health nurse manager. She believed that being a nurse and helping others was a great privilege and honor. She was passionate about assisting families and communities, which she did with a gentle heart and a good spirit of humility. After working for several years, Ms. Welsh needed more from her career. She then traveled to St. Lucia, where she pursued the nurse practitioner course, whereby she could offer more for her nurses as well as her clients. After working in the public sector for 40 years, Mrs. Welsh retired in 1996, but like many other nurses, felt she still had more to offer. Shortly after retiring from the public service, she was then asked by Dr. Derek Jeffers to work for his newly opened office as his nurse, which she started on the 3rd of February 1997, and did contribute another 3.5 years of exceptional service. Those of us who work and knew Nurse Welsh describe her as professional and trustworthy, with a quiet disposition.
As a nursing stalwart, she helped pave the way and broke barriers for generations of nurses after her. Today, we honor the life and work of Nurse Welsh and extend deep appreciation for her years of service to our country and a life well lived. The Ministry of Health is indeed highly indebted to public health nurse Ms. Margery Welsh for her significant role she played as a nurse midwife and the sterling and invaluable service she provided for the Federation of St. Kitts and Nevis. One author said, "The quality of our success in life is not measured by how we start, but how we live our lives, aligned without purpose, but how we end our chapter, experiencing fulfillment." We can all agree that, therefore, Mrs. Welsh lived a remarkable and fulfilling life. May her soul rest in eternal peace. On behalf of the staff of the community-based nursing services, institutional-based health services, St. Christopher and Nevis Nurses and Midwife Council, the St. Kitts and Nevis Nurses Association, the retired energetic nurses, and the Ministry of Health, I express profound condolences to the entire family. May the peace of God cover you during this time of loss and grief, and may you find comfort in our tribute in song, "God Will Take Care of You." Thank you.
before we invite the grandchildren. We will revert to the recording of Sister Gertrude Hobson. In the meantime, we acknowledge the presence of Brother Wilfred, widower, who has joined us, and the Deputy Governor of the ECCB, Dr. Valda Henry, who is with us as well. And just to remind us that we are here met to commend our dear sister, Margery Helen Welsh, into the hands of Almighty God, who sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer, by whose stripes we are healed, and in whose name alone we do have salvation. And so now we'll have the tribute recorded, then followed by the grandchildren, and then we invite Alex Condell to minister to us as well.
Good afternoon, guys. I can take this off.
Always have a lovely time together for 85 years, doing various things as children does. She was a very generous person and godly person. She do a lot of things in the Sunday school and all that she used to do. And then she, as she get to the stage where she can work for herself, she went into nursing, and that's where she, all these years, that's what she was, because she enjoyed caring for other people, and she made many friends during her time as a nurse. And she always never get into confusion or anything. She always have a good word to say about everybody, whether she knows them enough to say all these things. But she never have a bad word to say about anybody. She have four lovely children. She's one of a loving sister. And when she growing up, she sometimes thinks she's my mom, because she telling me what to do and telling me off. And I can look back at it now and laugh, you know. And if I'm wrong, she's always a person if I'm wrong. She would tell me I'm wrong. I'm always trying. She always tries, although she's only a year and a bit older than myself. She's always acting like a mom. And I can't thank her anymore for all the good that she done. She always helped me from my schoolwork or right up. She always there for me. And when I had my children, she was always there for me. And she always look after her mom, because that's the kind of person she is. So may she rest in peace, and God bless the family. And I hope they remember the blessed mom that brought them up into manhood and womanhood. And my sister, dear Margery, rest in peace. You'll always be in my mind. You'll never be forgotten. As the old saying goes, you're gone, but not forgotten. Love you very, very much. Your loving sister, Gertie.
Good afternoon, guys. My name is Andrew Welsh. I'm the eldest grandson, so I'll just be sharing a few words with you guys today. I'll also be speaking on behalf of my brother, because there are far too few opportunities for him to truly experience the loving grace of my grandmother, so for that, I'll be speaking on his behalf as well. What I'd like to share with you is simply just a memory. It was of her cooking as a child. 6 years of age, I believe. If not, the details are still fuzzy, but there's one thing that stands out is her cooking. She cooked without fat. Very unique, but it was full of flavor. I asked her one time, why did she do that? And she said, too much fat is bad for your heart. I looked at her. I said, okay. Ate, felt content, and went on to create more mischief. After many, many years of thinking on that moment, I realized, yeah, she was probably right about that, because I'm sitting kind of heavy right now, and it feels weird. But it also showed and displayed a sense of love and care and attention to care. She was willing to cook for everybody the same way to ensure that they had longevity, that they were shown love. Because of that, I know my grandmother will experience that kind of thing tenfold wherever she is. I'll always miss her, but I can always close my eyes and remind myself of that moment, and I no longer have to miss her. She lives within my memories, she lives within my thoughts, she lives within the stories that we share, and for that, I'll always miss her, but she will never be forgotten. And for that, that's the most important thing. So, thank you.
Good afternoon. Granny, too many memories to share. The summer days spent together, watching you in the afternoons tend to your garden, our trips to town and the market, lunches and dinners spent at your dinner table in love with your cooking. Now I'm older and I'm able to really appreciate your kind, tender, and nurturing spirit, which was seen and felt in everything you did. Even when you disciplined us, your tone was firm, but all the while gentle. My childhood is full of wonderful times. I will forever miss you. Most important of all, from you came my mom and now me. I will forever be grateful for your presence in my life. I am blessed to have had such a present grandmother tending to my every need. I love you always.
Good afternoon. Grandma, you will surely be missed. I know you are in a good place now. You served as an important pillar in my childhood, and I am forever grateful. From lessons on proper dining etiquette, and the long lectures on the importance of eating broccoli, to helping me pronounce the number 3 properly instead of saying tree, and scolding me when I misbehave. like the time I entered your garden of lilies to catch a crab and broke a few of your plants. I pray and hope you're looking over everyone as you always served as a guide and a source of inspiration for all of us.
Good afternoon, church. My granny was a definition of a superhero. She was a brilliant mother and grandmother, an excellent cook, and a hard-working nurse. Sorry. My granny was responsible for many of my childhood memories. The sweet smell of Caribbean cuisine always lingered in her home, and I would always look forward to visiting my granny and tasting her delicious food. My favorites included her famous chicken soup, her rice and peas. My granny often looked after me when my parents went out or when I was sick. While staying at my grandma's house, she would read the Bible to me and teach me the word of God. She would show me pictures of her younger self and would always say that the pictures from her wedding day were her favorite. When she took me on drives to get groceries, I would make fun of how old her car was, and she would kiss her teeth and laugh. My granny would tend to her garden every afternoon, and she took care of her beloved dog, Rovo. I would always be mischievous and joke along with my granny. If I was watching TV and she told me that it was bedtime, I would hide the TV remote and I would run and hide away from her when she called me to help with a chore. Eventually, Granny developed Alzheimer's and experienced memory loss, but some things never changed. She would still smile and close her eyes when she heard a song she liked. She still had her joyous laugh. She still screwed up her face if she thought I was wearing something that was too short. And the concerned look on her face when she saw my little sister doing acrobatics on the furniture never changed. I love you, Granny, and you will remain in my heart forever.
Hello, everyone. My beloved grandma meant everything to me, and I will never forget her. Although she is not physically here, her spirit is still as bright as ever in my heart. I remember when Granny would come every Sunday by us to go to church. While the band is playing, she would close her eyes and move her head as if she was having the time of her life. After church, we would enjoy a delicious meal of everything she loved. We always served her favorite pumpkin soup, played a playlist of gospel music, and had plenty of laughs and smiles. When Grandma moved in with us, it was the greatest thing for her and us because we were able to make more and more happy memories with her. Every day, Grandma would greet me with a morning kiss and a kiss goodnight. I'd walk into her room and Grandma's face would instantly light up like the sun. And I always enjoyed our conversations together. Even though I might not have always understood what Grandma was saying, I knew what her heart was saying. Just being with her was more than enough for me to know that she loved me with all her heart and wanted the best for me. Going on our family drives is one of my favorite memories of Grandma. We would take pictures and just take drives around St. Kitts, and I knew she was always happy to be out of the house. I know that Grandma is looking down from heaven and is feeling the best that she's ever felt. Grandma will always be in my heart forever, and I will always cherish the wonderful memories we had together.
Isa Kamal.
Good afternoon, family and friends. I am reading this formal remembrance on behalf of Margery Welsh's children, my cousins, Leroy, Wilfred Jr., and Pat and Sybil, who's standing here with me. This was written by Sybil. Christ-filled and Christ-like, grace and gracious, gentle and genteel, faith and faithful, beauty and beautiful, all these words aptly describe Lady Margery. Born Margery Helen Hobson on the 22nd of May 1936 in Hickman's Village, Nevis, she was the second of six children born to William Henry Hobson and Dorothy Hobson, both of Nevis. Her siblings included her older sister, Dorothy, now deceased, Gertrude, who resides in the UK, Joyce, who died as an infant, George, also deceased, and Ralston, also deceased. Mommy touched all who came into her presence. She lived first for God, and second for her husband and her four children, Leroy, Wilfred Jr., Patricia, and Sybil. And there was nothing within the realms of the Christian faith that she would not do for us. She gave her all and asked for nothing in return. Her love for family was truly unmatched. Daddy was the love of her life, and she beamed every time she spoke about him and defended him like a loyal soldier. He was her Wilfred, and when we and other close family members and friends would tease her, she would playfully respond, smiling and laughing, "Leave my Wilfred alone. You all are jealous." Mommy never failed to let her children know that she loved us equally and had no favorites. She loved us unconditionally, not because of what we did, but despite what we did or failed to do. Her simple explanation for all the sacrifices she made for her family was simply, "That's what a mother would do." Sharing and caring was part of Mom's essence. She shared the big and the little things. While we lived among fruit trees in abundance, in the off season, if a mango, guava, or sugar apple was discovered, bet your life it would be divided for all to sample. And if one of us were to make the point that one or more was not at home, and never needed to know about the fruit, she would gently respond that she had a husband and four children, not one, or two, or three, and all would partake. Mommy's extended family and friends also felt her love and care. She was caretaker in chief, looking after her late nephew Winfred and her late brother George, who was affectionately called brother, whom she took to live with her during periods when they needed her support, love, strength, and guidance. It was not just a duty, but an honor for her to care for her mother, Mama, who she called Mama, to the very end. One would feel the love and warmth when Mommy got together with her siblings, nieces, nephews, in-laws, and friends. Love and affection punctuated their chatter, laughter, and embraces. Mommy loved to smile and laugh. Her eyes would twinkle and glisten. Her cheeks would get round, and she would radiate with pure joy. When she stayed by the Hendricksons during her travels from Nevis to St. Kitts in her early nursing days, before moving to St. Kitts, her cousins recollect how they looked forward to her visits. She brought gifts of love, care, and compassion, in addition to the goodies that she would carefully select for each of them. Cooking was another way for Mommy to share her love. Growing up, the kitchen was a festive place for cooking numerous dishes, be it corn with okra, fried steam or baked fish or chicken, stewed meat, black pudding, goat water, homemade tomato ketchup, Johnny cakes, hot cocoa accompanying fried jacks. chicken, and vegetable soups, among other delights. A balanced meal was a must, and vegetables and salads were mainstays at the kitchen table. She would eventually cut out red meat on health grounds, to the dismay of all who lived for her stewed beef out of the Dutch oven, or what we used to know as the Dovin Pot back in those days. When it came to baking, Mom would assign roles. Leroy would happily take the task of mixing the batter so that he could feast on what was left in the bowl, ignoring the warning that he should not do such because the batter contained raw eggs. The task of beating the eggs, greasing the pans, and washing the dishes were distributed among us three who remained. Visitors to church on a Sunday would end up at the Sunday table for a sumptuous lunch. Often, cousins Vira and Vernice, and when in Sinkett's Tony, would visit on a Sunday to sample Mommy's stewed meats and her rice and peas. Added to this, anyone stopping by for a Sunday afternoon visit would be served cookies or cake with homemade juices, including soursop, lemonade, passion fruit, ginger beer, or a mix. Mommy took equal pride in her juices, and they were always some new concoction. The highest compliment that our children would bestow on us was that our cooking came close to Mommy's cooking. Mommy had a big heart, big enough for all, and a penchant for giving that often confounded her, family circle. You would always hear her say in the face of strife, "Blessed are the peacemakers," and a soft word turns away wrath. It was this enormous heart that led her to the nursing profession. She qualified in Jamaica as a nurse and later pursued additional studies and gained the qualifications of nurse practitioner. She served diligently and faithfully in the health service for several decades. Her caring nature and her ability to empathize with her patients gave her the name "Nice Nurse" by the school children awaiting vaccinations. Everyone wanted to be in line for the nice nurse. Her smile was genuine and beautiful, and her touch was calm and gentle. Her voice was reassuring and soothing. This carried over when she went to work for Dr. Derek Jeffers as his first nurse, as he navigated the journey of a young gynecologist launching out on his own on February 3rd, 1997. He would make it known that Mommy was key to the success of his early medical practice. Patients would give high praise not only for her professionalism and skill, but also her soothing words of comfort and wise counsel during challenging times. Such counsel was always embedded in the Word of God. Next to her family, Dr. Derek Jeffers was there right at the top of Mommy's favorite list. She had utmost respect and love for her doctor. Dare anyone to call him aloof, and she would quickly defend her doctor with the Margery armor of love, letting them know that behind his stoic disposition was a caring doctor, deeply affected by his patient's pain and suffering, and rejoicing every time he's able to save a life that appeared to be at the end of the road. Nursing, however, was her second calling. Her first was to serve the Lord, and she was active in her church, both in Nevis and in Sinkett's, as a Sunday school teacher, youth leader, lay preacher, class leader, and class member. It was as a youth leader and active member of her Methodist church in Dieppe Bay that she met young Wilfred and later married and raised a family. They tried their utmost to imbue in us a godly spirit. Church was a must, followed by Sunday school and Sunday family devotion. Mommy sent her boys to learn piano lessons with the church organist, Mrs. Brown, hoping to expand their religious instruction. Wilfred Jr. appeared not to have an interest in music, and Leroy ditched the lessons with the church organist, opting instead to learn music with a secular band. The seed planted by Mommy, however, was not in vain, as her grandsons, Andrew and Aaron, ended up playing the organ in church during their younger days. As we became young adults, Mommy would let us know that no matter how late we came home from partying, we had to be in church on Sunday, or we will not get the car to go out the next weekend. Heaven knows we ended up in church with only 2 to 3 hours sleep and hardly heard a word of what the preacher was saying. But we made sure we were in church, sleeping with eyes wide open and back straight, standing at the appropriate times. Mommy extended her care and love beyond her family circle, making weekly visits to minister to persons in her communities and the Cardin home. Mommy lived her truth. Quotes and phrases written in her diaries provide sound instruction, sound prescriptions for living, and reflect how Mommy lived her life. These quotes and phrases, some of which are at the end of each page of the funeral booklet, include the following. A spark of encouragement can rekindle warmth in the heart. The Holy Spirit leads, but you have to be patient. The Bible says that he who trusted in his own heart is a fool. Obey God and leave all consequences to him. Faith begins when the will of God is known. Fellowship is a place of grace, where mistakes aren't rubbed in, but rubbed out. Fellowship begins when mercy wins over justice. Speak the truth in love. Thoughtless words leave lasting wounds. Pride builds walls between people. Humility builds bridges. Humility is not thinking less of yourself. It is thinking of yourself less. We can't keep the birds from flying over our head, but we can keep them from nesting in our hair. Be open to the Holy Spirit. We need to pray that God will work mightily in our lives. Misdirected anger is wrong. Fill the bridge of hope to the world. And her three L's were listening, learning, and leading. Mommy was not interested in earthly wealth. She invested financially in her family's interests, but claimed none. She would respond when asked why her name was absent from any deed. You can't take anything with you. Empty-handed I came, and empty-handed I will return to my Lord. My inheritance is in heaven. Go on, Lady Margery. You have inherited it all. God has welcomed you into his heavenly palace.
Greetings and blessed love to everyone. And a special greeting to the family, of course. I know that this is not one of the more brighter times in your family's life. However, I want us to take this moment and use it as what it is. It's a celebration of her transition. She has transitioned from this very dangerous plane that we live on and have joined the likes of her own ancestors to live in eternal bliss, eternal love, eternal light. Now, when Miss Welsh called me, I was filled with such great emotions. I feel honored, actually, to be able to present like this here. And then I started thinking about what it is that would be the most respectful tribute to a lady like Lady Margery. And I started thinking, I'm trusting that this medley of well-known and classic hymns will provide comfort to all of us at this time. Be still, my soul, the Lord is on your side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to your God to order and provide. In every change, He faithful will remain. Be still, my soul, your best, your heavenly friend. Through thorny ways leads to a peaceful end. Be still, my soul, the hour is hastening on. When we purest joys restored. Be still, my soul, when change and tears are past. Should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart feel lonely? And long for heaven and home. When Jesus is my portion, yes, I know he watches. I know he watches. I know he watches. I know he watches. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when souls like sea billows, thou hast called me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. If you know it, feel free to sing along. It is well. With my soul, it is well, it is well with you.
And all God's people said, amen. We sing to the great Jehovah as we sing the hymn, Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. As we receive the offering at this time, remain seated as we sing. Thank you.
see your faithfulness. Through thick times with him, a goodness of faithfulness has never failed.
Now we come to this point where we say goodbye and so long to one whom we knew and loved, in our sister Margery. And now we step out on that faithfulness that indeed you will see us through. We pray, gracious God, now as we offer back a portion of what you have blessed us with, monetary wise, we give of ourselves and place ourselves and that which we offer into your faithful hands, knowing that that which you keep is well kept. Bless us even as you bless them, to your honor, to your service. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. You may be seated, and we invite the Challengers Methodist Church to render their tribute. You will note that our sister, in moving around, touched different churches. K.G. Swanston in Deer Bay, Ebenezer, Challengers, and Wesley. So we invite Challengers at this time to render their item.
We now come to trust here from the words of the Holy Scripture, and we invite Helen Welsh, our son, to be a seeing of the peace.
In the morning, as they passed by, they saw the fig tree withered away to its roots. Then Peter remembered and said to him, that is Jesus, Rabbi, look, the fig tree that you cursed has withered. Jesus answered him, have faith in God. Truly I tell you, if you say to this mountain, be taken up and thrown into the sea, and you do not doubt in your heart, but believe that what you say will come to pass, it will be done for you. So I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. Whenever you stand praying, forgive. If you have anything against anyone, so that your Father in heaven may also forgive you your trespasses. The Gospel of Christ. The hymn, How Great Thou Art. Amen, amen. You may be seated. Allow me, brothers and sisters, and the family, to Brother Wilfred, and to daughters present, and sons overseas, extended family, to extend to you, on behalf of the ministerial staff, officers and members of this circuit, our condolences, our prayers, as you mourn the loss of your matriarch, the love of your life, and one who perhaps was the glue that kept the family together. I trust that as you go through this time of feeling unglued, that you'll find the real glue in Jesus Christ, who is the one who is able to keep you from falling. I invite Reverend Tyrone Hunkins, who is at present the pastor of Challengers, where our brother and sister members there, and he will tell you a childhood friend as well. And so I invite him now to bring the pastoral message.
Greetings, everyone. Thank you very much, Reverend Mark, for this opportunity to share in a service I never ever imagined I would have the pleasure to share in. You've offered condolences, Reverend Mark, on behalf of the staff of which I'm a part. But just permit me on a personal note, and if I may say, especially on behalf of my deceased brother, Hillary Hunkins, through whom I had the pleasure of coming to know the Welches. Brother Wilfred Welsh and his wife, Sister Margery Welsh, and the children at the time when Brother Welsh was the manager at the Lambert's estate. That's how long I knew the family. And my brother was very close to the Welches, and it is through him, as I indicated before, that I got to know the entire family. And I was very fond of all of them, and especially the children. But of course, Junior, that's the Wilfred Junior, I was a little closer to him because we had something in common. What we had in common is that we had a love for the foreign languages, and he had a great love for French. And at a time when even in school you can't find somebody to practice your French with, Junior was just a very good person to speak to. And I want to say, Junior, know that you're listening, so you couldn't make it. Was looking forward to seeing you. But thanks for those opportunities that we had to share. Sister Welsh was someone I really admired very, very much. I hardly heard her speak, and when she speaks, it was in that soft, gentle, peaceful way. And as I thought of her, it seems to me that if the maximum volume was 10, she probably spoke under 1. But when I listened to the announcement, I recognized that it seemed as though she touched the whole world. Because when the announcement began, that the death announcement on the radio,
and you're listening, and then you go to do something and you come back, and you go to do something and you come back, and it's the same announcement. Still waters run deep. We want to give God thanks generally for the family, Brother Welsh and his wonderful family, your great children, and we want to especially say thanks to God for the life of Sister Margery. I say that on behalf of my deceased brother and the rest of the Hunkins family. It's been a pleasure to know her, and since going away, coming back after 30 years, I had the pleasure of becoming her minister and also to share with her in ministry. She lived a great life. The eulogy spoke for itself, and those of us who knew her knew that she had a life well lived for God. May her soul rest in peace. May God's perpetual light shine on her. And may the pain that you feel and the emptiness and the aching void that you must feel after sharing all these years, Brother Welsh, and all your life, children, with such a wonderful person, my encouragement to you is that no matter how difficult it is, how empty it feels at her absence, how difficult it may be to carry on without her, my encouragement to you is have faith in God. Have faith in God. Let us pray. Gracious God, life brings us into some very difficult experiences from time to time. And as we saw the children and the grandchildren in pain for the loss of their mom, their grandma, we pray, God, that they may continue to reach out to you. And despite what this experience of loss may bring to them, bring to us, and despite the other challenges that we have been through and continue to go through in our lives, may we find comfort by having faith and placing that faith in God. I ask you to guide me as I seek to encourage this family and all of us who mourn. I ask this, that I ask the power of your Holy Spirit to enable me to share these words. And I ask it in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. If there's a word of encouragement and comfort that I speak today to all who hear my voice, it is found in the words of Jesus, as was read to us from Mark chapter 11, when at the shock of Peter to discover that something Jesus said, spoke in their hearing, had come to pass. Jesus in response said to him, simply, have faith in God. Have faith in God. Do you really have faith in God? Perhaps you've said, yes, I have faith in God.
But just let me remind you that faith in God is not merely giving an assent or a nod of the head to say, yes, I have faith in God. It's not just speaking the words. It is demonstrating it in your life. What is faith? There are thousands, no doubt, of definitions that would tell us what is faith. And I'm sure that perhaps even based on our experience, each of us may very well give a different definition for what faith is to us. And I just want to share from the scriptures the definition given in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1. And I read from the New Revised Standard Version. It says, now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. A key word there is assurance. So when you have faith, then you are supposed to have assurance, which means that you really should have no doubt. And when you have faith in God, then it means that you feel assured that whatever it is that you're trusting God to do in your life will come to pass. Because assurance means I am certain that it will happen. And I'm prepared to trust God for that. Faith to come to pass. For faith is the assurance you have of things that are hoped for. Some of us practice a faith in God where we can only say thanks to God when we have already received the blessings in our hands. But a true faith in God is one that the moment you begin to pray and you deposit your faith in God, the moment you do that, it's the moment you know you can thank God, for you have the assurance, no doubt, that the thing you ask for, the thing you are trusting God for, will come to pass. Faith is assurance for the things, not that you have now, but the things you hope to receive at a later point. But faith is conviction. Conviction. Again, you are convinced. Again, without doubt, that the things that you cannot see with your naked eyes, but you know you need or must have, will be yours because you have faith in the right person. Not in your husband, not in your wife, not in your best friend, not so much in your neighbors, not faith in your own strength and abilities, but faith in God, the God to whom nothing is impossible. So what are you facing today?
How is life with you today? It's a rhetorical question. I don't want you to tell me your life story now, because I ask, how is life with you today? But what I want you to do is to look inside for a moment. And I will assure you that if you would just look for a short moment inside of yourself, you probably will find more than enough trouble, that perhaps your lips would fail you if you were to share the troubles in your life. But today I'm here to tell you that there is no trouble that you can see or experience. There is no darkness that is too dark for God to shed his light upon that darkness. It doesn't matter how thick that darkness may be. If you have faith in God, that faith will become light in your life, and you will no longer stumble and grope through the darkness, because you have deposited your faith in God. Some of us have faith, but we have deposited our faith in our bank accounts. So we know that as long as we have a couple of $1 million on the national bank, we are good for life. So our faith is in our bank account, or perhaps deposited in our pockets. So our faith can only be seen as long as we have the power to write a check from our checkbooks. And we measure our faith based on how much money we have, how much property we have. But that is not faith. A faith in God is a faith that keeps you alive, that keeps you hopeful, that keeps going even when the going gets tough and rough. You are going because you are stepping out by faith. Sometimes in life, and some of us may be able to identify with that, you're going, but you don't know where you're going. You can't see. And sometimes even as you step, something tells you, where are you going? You don't see life is over. You seek to make another step. And each step you make, there is a voice telling you, no, it's over. It's done. Why don't you just take your life? There isn't anything more to live for. And today, we are hearing of suicides. Suicides. When you get to a point where you begin to contemplate and to put things in place to end the life of beauty that God has given to you, you have lost your faith. But today I want to encourage you. I don't know your story. I don't know what it is that brings you pain in life. I don't know. But I know that many of you are going through a lot. Some have given up and lost faith. Well, God, well, I have tried everything that I could do. I've done everything. But I'm still not happy. So, that's it for me. And then they end their life. How sad. How painful. That we have lost some of our greatest people around us.
gifted, intelligent, but they are no longer, because maybe some of them would have placed the faith in their ability to work hard and to earn a living. And the day they lost the job and there was no longer a paycheck, that was the end of life. If you put your faith in the wrong place, you're sure to fail. But if you put your faith in God, then brothers and sisters, rather than your experiences in life overcoming you, if you place your faith in God, then you will overcome your troubles in life. Why do I want you to have faith in God? I want to give you three reasons for having faith in God. One, when you have faith in God, it is a step in the right direction. Faith motivates. Faith is a motivator. I'll come back to that. Secondly, faith justifies. And thirdly, faith overcomes / conquers. Let me go back to the number one. Faith motivates. Have you ever been really, really hungry? And what do you do when you are hungry? You set your mind on something to eat. There's some people, once they're in school, and hunger begins to strike, they can't hear anything else that the teacher is saying, because the stomach is speaking louder than the teacher. Some people walk off the job because they are hungry. Well, faith in God is a motivator, just as hunger is. And hunger gets you to the restaurant if you have the money. So when you're hungry, then it can be used as a motivator to move you towards God. Because we are made to worship God. We are creatures of worship. And God placed us on this earth so that we may give Him honor and glory. And faith motivates us. It sets us on the road to giving God the glory that is due to His name. So when you have faith and you place that faith in God, it motivates you to do the right thing, even when the right thing does not feel like the right thing. Even when the right thing does not seem as though it will bring you what you hope for. Someone said this about faith. Faith is the bird that sees the light. Have you ever felt the light? The bird, faith is the bird that feels the light. It begins to feel the light and sings to greet the dawn while it is still dark. If you can't sing unless you see the light, that's not faith. But if, when you are in the darkest hour of your experience in life, if in the midnight hour you can find a song to sing at midnight, that's faith. when Paul and Silas were in jail, in the midnight hour, they sang. Faith is singing when life is darkest and most despairing and most hopeless for you. Faith is singing because you know that the dawn is still ahead. It motivates you to go in the right direction. Secondly, faith justifies. Faith justifies. There's something called justification. And the Word of God tells us that we are justified by faith. And what does that really mean? When we are justified by faith, it is not saying that we are perfect. No, not at all. It is saying that even when we are at our worst, our most sinful state in life, even when we have failed most miserably, even when we have let God down to the uttermost, that we can still have faith in God. Because it is that faith in God that will justify us. Which means that when you have faith in God, even though you are a sinner, perhaps the greatest of sinners, there is still hope for you. Because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, did I just call your name? Yes, I did. Whosoever. Some people will make you feel that they are better than you are. Some people will tell you to your face that I'm holier than you. And so the little I is holier than thou, as though they never made a mistake in life, as though they never sinned against themselves or God or their neighbors. Some people will make you feel condemned to death and condemned to hell, but I'm here to say to you that even if you are the greatest sinner by name and nature in Sinkits, a faith in God will justify you. It is sure of you that if you say, or if we say, we have no sin, what are we doing to ourselves? We are deceiving ourselves. We are only lying to ourselves. We are not fooling anybody else. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth of God is not in us. But when we recognize our sinfulness and we turn to God in faith, believing that no matter how bad things are, no matter how tough, no matter how dark, no matter how sinful, no matter how wicked we have become, there is hope. For once we ask God to forgive us, God forgives us. Can I say that again? Once you ask God to forgive you of your sin, God forgives you. Don't forget that. God will forgive you. Others may hold it against you for the rest of life, but don't worry about that. A faith in God is not the same thing as a faith in man. And if you put your faith in man, you will never make another step. When you make a mistake, or when you sin against God, or when you fall, you will never make another step if you put your faith in man. But today I'm here to say, a faith in God will justify you. When you're justified, it means that God will look at you when you have made your confession, and God would say, your sins are forgiven. He promises that as far as the east is from the west, so far will I remove your sins from you. That's God. And that's why you need to have faith in God. For the faith in God will justify you in such a way that even though you're guilty and deserving of the worst punishment, God is welcoming you and saying, as he said to the Israelites, he said to the Israelites, come now, in Isaiah chapter 1, verses 18 to 20. Israel were wicked. They were wicked to God, disobedient to God. But yet, God says in verse 18 to 20, verses 18 to 20, come now, let us argue, let us reason together. That's what God said to Israel, the wicked, unfaithful, disobedient Israel. Come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as snow. And though they be red like crimson, they shall become like wool. That's justification. That though you're guilty, God washes you away, washes your sin away, and puts you in a position of perfect relationship with God. Hallelujah to that. And he said, if you are willing and if you are obedient, to come and let's reason it out, so that I can understand where you are, so that I can give you assurance that even though you have fallen, even though you have sinned, even though you have transgressed, that I will wash your sins white as snow and make it look like wool. So if you're willing and you're obedient, then you shall reap the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured by the sword. And he says, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. Not my words. So faith in God justifies. When you confess your sin to God, God places you in a right relationship with him. And finally, faith in God, brothers and sisters, not only motivates you in the right direction, not only justify you, but faith in God overcomes and conquers anything in your way, any challenge in your path. In the passage that was read from the Gospel, we read how Jesus, if we would have read a little earlier, we would have seen that Jesus on his journey to Jerusalem saw a fig tree. He was very, very hungry, and he saw a fig tree. And he walked up to the fig tree hoping to find something to eat. And when he walked up to the fig tree, there wasn't anything on the fig tree for him to eat. So he spoke some words to the fig tree. And he said to the fig tree, from now on, no one shall ever eat fruit from you again. The disciples heard when he spoke, but it was just some words that Jesus spoke. It didn't mean much to them, although he spoke those words in their hearing. And they continued on the journey. But then the next morning, I had reason to pass back that same way. And when they passed back, Peter looked a and discovered something that shocked him. The tree to which Jesus spoke and said, nobody will ever eat from you again, was dried up, withered down to its very roots. It was withered, dried up from last night to this morning. The power of God. So Peter said, but Jesus, look, the fig tree is dried up. He was amazed, he was shocked, he was confused, he was everything. Jesus just turned to him and said, have faith in God. Brothers and sisters, it is a lesson for us. When we have faith in God, we can use God's name, we can use God's power to overcome the challenges in our lives. Jesus crossed the fig tree. It dried up to its roots. And then he said to his disciples in verse 23 of Mark 11, truly I tell you, if you say to this mountain, be taken up and thrown into the sea, and if you do not doubt in your heart, but believe that what you say will come to pass, it will be done for you. If you believe, if you don't doubt, and you speak to the mountains in your life, God will move them. And the mountains that are hindering you from going forward with God, when you speak to them and say, move over to yonder place, your mountain, you go into the sea, the God who gave you the authority and power will surely move those mountains. Brothers and sisters, once again I ask you to look inside of yourself. Look back on your years of experience. Look back over the time you know yourself and how many times you have stumbled, how many times you have fallen, how many times you have failed and failed miserably in your own eyes, in the eyes of those around you, and even in the eyes of God. You have failed, but today I tell you, life is not over for you, and all hope is not gone. Today, I leave you thinking, I leave you meditating, I leave you seeking to believe and to put these words at work in your heart and in your life, no matter where you are. Your back is against the wall, and as some people say, in life you've hit rock bottom. It's not too late to cry out in faith. God have mercy upon me, for that faith will get you going in the right direction. It will motivate you towards God. That faith will put you in the right direction, in the right relationship with God. That it will justify you, and that God, when others are condemning you to death, God will treat you as a friend. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. God is calling you to have faith in him so that you could be justified by the blood of Jesus Christ. Receive pardon and enjoy a right relationship with God that will finally cause you to overcome, because Jesus said, the word of God said, faith is the victory that overcomes the world. When you have faith in God, truly exercised, not in yourself, in your friend, in your family, in your intelligence, in your power and your strength, but when you exercise faith in God, you would be an overcomer of the world. For faith is the victory that overcomes the world. Have faith. No matter what you're going through,
have faith in God. Amen. I'll invite you to stand and we affirm that faith that we have in God in the Apostles' Creed. It's printed in the order. Together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. We bow as we give God thanks for the life of our dear sister. Let us pray. Father God, we come to you, giving you thanks for the life of Sister Margery Helen Welsh. We have experienced her at different points in our lives and in her life. She has lived her life and given that life to you. She has lived, O God, as best as she could, according to your direction and your expectation of her. And in the process, she has touched many lives. And each of us, no doubt, have our own personal testimonies about the way in which her quiet, gentle, genuine, spirit-filled life would have influenced ours. Because of her, Lord, many who did not know God would have come to know God when they recognized the peace in her life, that peace that passes all understanding. Because of her, there are those who have been motivated to go towards God because they see her faith in God. And they have determined, likewise, I will place my faith in God. Because of her Christian witness, God, there are those who have been led to confess their sins to God and developed a right relationship with God. Because of her life and testimony, there are those who would otherwise have failed, but because of her Christian witness, they were able to trust God, to place their faith and confidence in God, and they have become overcomers. And today, some of them can say that in all these things, no matter what I've been through, in all these things, we are more than conquerors. God, we thank you for her family, her life lived with her husband all those years together in love and faithfulness. We thank you for her children, whom she, along with her husband, would have brought up in the fear and nurture and admonition of the Lord. We thank you for her witness to her children, as we heard, and even the grandchildren, and to her witness in community. She has journeyed, as we have heard in the eulogy, from the church, Methodist Church in Dieppe Bay. She moved to Ebenezer in Old Road, according to their occupation.
She moved to Challengers. Today, her service is being held in Wesley, a place that she also was a member in this church. But today, I believe she's making her final move from earth to heaven. From earth to heaven. Receive her soul and let her soul rest in eternal peace. Give her eternal life and eternal salvation. And let your perpetual light ever shine upon her. Thank you, Lord, for her beautiful life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now we will commend our dear sister into the hands of Almighty God. Let us stand for the commendation. Eternal God, who have made us all and hid nothing that you have made, and have given your Son for our redemption, we commend our dear sister, Margery Helen Welsh, to your perfect mercy and wisdom. Eternal rest grant unto her, and let perpetual light shine upon her. We will remain standing and we will share in the singing or chanting of the Lord's Prayer. I'm not sure if I should tell you be seated because it's the next hymn, but Reverend Mark will give you further instructions. Reverend Mark.
Brothers and sisters, we close with the Methodist anthem, "And Can It Be?" We remain standing for the benediction and the recessional that follows thereafter. "And Can It Be That I Should Gain?"
we receive the benediction. Now the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good thing to do his will, working in you that is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Remain standing for the recessional.
Share.
Father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him, for he knows our frame, he remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are as grass. As the flower of the field, so he flourishes, for the wind passes over it and it is done, and the place thereof shall know it no more. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children. We know that neither death nor life, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature can separate us from the love of God, which is in Jesus Christ our Lord. We know that if this earthly house of our tabernacle be dissolved, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Since our sister's departed of this life, and Almighty God in his mercy has taken her to himself, we therefore commit her body to the ground. Dust to dust, ashes to ashes, earth to earth. Sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ.
I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, from henceforth blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Even so saith the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. Let us pray. We have three short prayers, at the end of which we invite you to say Amen. Let us pray. O merciful God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of mercies and God of all comfort, raise us up, we pray, from death of sin to new life, to the new life of righteousness, that when we shall depart this life, we shall be found acceptable in your sight. This we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Grant to the bereaved consolation and faith in this time of distress and trial, the blessed hope in the coming of your kingdom, the sustaining grace in the fellowship of your people, and the steadfastness in the service of your name, and the doing of your will, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Support us, O Lord, all the day long of this troublous life, until the shadows lengthen, the evening comes, the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant unto us safe lodging, holy rest, and peace at the last. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The hymn, Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself.
Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself. God who joins us by his grace and bids us here to be restored together. Jesus sing his mercy and his grace, to be followed by when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he prepared for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all
poem going of Mrs. Margery Helen Welsh. I say home going because from a Christian point of view, there are those of us who believe in Almighty God, the creator of the world, and also believe that this world is not our final home. Margery's time in this world is ended, and she has gone to be with our Lord God Almighty, His Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and all of those persons who serve Him faithfully. Wilfred and Margery, as husband and wife in this life, have made our contributions to society with the help of Almighty God and His Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we thank both for the love and all of the blessings bestowed on us. However, the time has come when Margery has gone to be with the Lord God in glory. The Methodist Church has been the source of inspiration to Margery and Wilfred in serving our Lord God Almighty and His Savior, Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We have served in certain positions in the Methodist Church, and the interactions brought us together. At the Methodist Church in Cape Bay, Margery was a local preacher. We both lived in Cape Bay, and we attended the Methodist Church there, and I was a member of the choir, and Margery was a local preacher and leader of a youth group in which we had a shared interest. And because of the interaction, we became lovers and then got married. By profession, Margery was a public health nurse and I was an estate manager. And we lived together on the estates where I worked. We were able to have children, and the number of children we have are 4. 2 boys and 2 girls. Thanks to God for His blessings. I now end by extending hearty thanks to all who extend their support and best wishes to me and my family. And we thank you for your presence at this funeral service. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you.
We have at this time the laying of the wreaths. Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore.
Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.